the historical roots of the rapidly expanding cult of Mary with the worship of ancient goddesses and other pagan practices have been examined in an earlier chapter. Such links now seem to strengthen what we assumed before, or even proved before. The New Age movement is undoubtedly advancing on many fronts, not least in the church, which will not endure sound doctrine having itching ears. Many Christians have drunk deep draughts of New Age potions. For example, holistic health, hypnosis, yoga, inner healing, meditation, psychical research and awareness training, and many have imbibed new doctrines and heresies based on the humanistic and positive thinking of Teilhard de Chardin, Norman Vincent Peale and others, which provide the Church with its emphasis on an earthly kingdom now, the social gospel and society reconstructed for Christianized with kingdom principles for the Lord's return. Restorationist leader Bryn Jones, writing in the beginning of 1991, promised his followers that, quote, "By the power of his Spirit, we will bring all that is against God and man beneath Christ's authority. God's Church will be the most influential body of people on earth in the final period of this age." Unquote. This is indeed a prophetic word, but it is fulfilled in Scripture only by the apostate church of the book of Revelation. Hello and welcome to a new video, a new reading of a new book. I mean, it's the second reading of All Roads Lead to Rome. From Juggler 66, Hour of the Truth. I'm happy to be here again to finish chapter 1, The Background of Ecumenism, and then read to you the second chapter, which is called Roman Catholic Doctrine and the Mass, as the title of the video is. So, opposed to what I've said earlier about the video making, my brother in Christ, Brett Norman, over there in Minnesota in the United States of America, has declared himself free to look up to me a few photos, so I sent him the recording when done. And he picks out a few photos that I will match into the video at the appropriate minutes. So, you see, it is not only these 150-something pictures that I selected to come over and over again. We are still doing a little work to fix the right pictures with the right videos, with the right reading. But because he helps me, that takes a lot of work off me, and I can more concentrate on doing the readings, which is a little bit more important to do. In that way, I don't have to work that long on the videos anymore. So we are now going back to chapter 1, where we left off last reading, that is the background to ecumenism. And the last part of the chapter is called the evangelical divide, and I will continue reading there. That is on page 30, for if anyone has an own copy of his book and wants to read along with me. At the 1977 National Evangelical Anglican Congress, the NEAC at Nottingham, David Watson spoke of the Reformation as, quote, "one of the greatest tragedies that ever happened to the Church," unquote, and went on to tell of when he had attended a Catholic Protestant Charismatic Conference in Dublin, how he had come to sense the profound grief that God must feel at the separation of his body, unquote. Well, I personally do not believe that God must feel any profound grief that comes from the separation of this body, because this body, the Roman Catholic Church, is not his body. The Roman Catholic Church always was, is, and always will be the Church of Satan, the synagogue of Satan. God will be glad for everyone who come out of it. And read Revelation 18, verse 4, where it states, "Come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and that you do not receive of her plagues." This, of course, is something David Watson was not thinking about, that there are people who read and understand the Bible, and put the Bible, and the Bible alone, sola scriptura, as the basis for their authority when they speak of biblical dogma. Opposite to what the Roman Catholic Church does, eh? Michael Harper has spoken of his own ecumenical pilgrimage in terms of the three major spiritual influences in the contemporary church. In his book, This is the Day, Canon Harper speaks of three sisters whose names are Evangeline, Charisma, and Roma, representing the evangelical and charismatic movements and the Roman Catholic Church, which was once anathema to him, but in which he has found a deepening of his profound loving commitment to Christ and God. I just ask myself, what spirit is leading someone who can find in that Roman Catholic Church a living commitment to Christ and God of the Bible? I don't get it. Brother Raymond, the Anglican Society of St. Friscus, writing in his handbook on spiritual retreats, continues, quote, "When Michael's prejudices had melted, he came to love those he had previously rejected, meeting Christ in them and learning from them the Holy Spirit through them. The treasure stores of Catholic life opened their riches to him. In a disarming biblical manner," he says, quote, "The Virgin Mary has come alive, and I feel I know her now, in the same way as my evangelical heritage helped me to know St. Paul." Unquote. God's creation, gifts of creativity, nature, and nature's art all come to life, and the Church corporate with its pre-Reformation riches took on a new meaning. The sacraments were no longer lifeless mechanical rites, but effectual signs that work where there is faith. Since meeting Roma, Holy Communion became an oasis in a parched desert. Unquote. From Brother Raymond. Probably not a brother of mine. Leading evangelical John Stott, an advisor to the World Council of Churches, told the Nottingham NEAC Conference, so the National Evangelical Anglican Congress, that the visible unity of all professing Christians should be our goal, and evangelicals should join others in the Church of England and working towards full communion with the Roman Catholic Church. That same year, 1977, John Stott went to Venice to be part of Evangelical Roman Catholic Dialogue and Mission on Mission. Respected evangelical theologian J.I. Packer has added his weight to the arguments in support of ecumenical renewal. Quote, "Do I see renewal in the Roman Catholic Church? As a Protestant, for whom major elements of official Catholicism represents Christianity skewed, I reply that I do. It is as these streams of renewal continue to flow and hopefully converge that the Catholic Church will give most to the rest of Christendom and to the benighted pagan world of our time." Unquote. So he professes to be a Protestant and says that even though he resents, the major elements of official Catholicism, and he replies that he does, that he sees renewal in the Roman Catholic Church. Renewal always only comes from one side, from the Protestant Church. Rome never changes. It never changed in the past, it doesn't change now, and it will never change in the future. Now, after reading all this, we come at the end of chapter 1, finally, to some warning voices. American evangelical David W. Cloud takes an entirely different view of what's going on. From Rome's perspective, he quotes, "there could not be a more effective instrument toward the agenda set forth by Rome, which is building up the Catholic Church and re-establishing Catholic dominion than the gullible, misled charismatic movement. I'm going to read that again because that's a very, very, very important sentence. From Rome's perspective, there could not be a more effective instrument towards the agenda set forth by Rome, which is building up the Catholic Church and re-establishing Catholic dominion, than the gullible, misled charismatic movement. So here actually this person, David W. Cloud, says it is all about Roman Catholic dominion restoring. That is what the New World Order is all about. Restoring the old world order, the time before the Reformation when the Pope had the power over the kings of the earth, of the then known earth in the Western Hemisphere. The part that the Roman Catholic government, I like to say even, the church and the political Roman Empire that was garmented with Christianity ruled at that time. And the Reformation took that away, because all of a sudden the people were giving the Bible to read for themselves. You know, when you went in the Middle Ages to the church, Mass was held in Latin and people didn't understand it. And the Bible was read from in Latin and people didn't understand that. So that's why the priest needed to explain to them what in the Bible stands. But of course, he can't tell you anything if you don't understand the language it's written in, right? And the Reformation made sure that the people got hands on the Bible, on the Word of God for themselves in the very first time. That ended the Dark Ages, that ended the Old World Order, and the New World Order is nothing else than the Old World Order restored. And in other words, David W. Cloud says that here in his quote. He continues, "It is a movement which, by claiming to believe that Catholics and all people need to be born again, sees absolutely no need of warning of Rome's wretched and blasphemous errors, or of instructing those who are saved to come out of that apostasy. Rome has found a winner," unquote, with the charismatic movement. Concerned Protestant groups like the Church of England's Church Society and Protestant Alliance, founded by the 7th Earl of Shaftesbury, claim that the price of charismatic renewal and new evangelicalism is much too high. Dr. David Samuel, the director of Church Society, writing in 1990, warned that, quote, "We are seeing the reviving of that ancient regime with its focus in the papacy, something which we might not have believed possible in the 1870s, when the Pope's temporal power was eclipsed and the fortunes of the Vatican seemed to be declining. We have seen a remarkable revival of that institution which is intended to head up an ecclesiastical empire created by the ecumenical movement." Unquote. The ecumenical movement has gained considerably, if not irresistible, momentum, as a Protestant leader sees it. Vital differences in belief have become blurred by, and the Protestant Reformation virtually reversed. George Aston, secretary of the Protestant Alliance, believes that Christians need a clear reminder of these things. Quote, "The reformers saw the whole Catholic system as anti-Christian. Luther and Calvin went so far as to identify the papacy with the Antichrist, and they, like Wycliffe, Tyndale, Matthew Henry, C.H. Spurgeon, Lloyd Jones, and many others, saw the Roman Catholic institution as Mystery Babylon, the mother of harlots, vividly described in Revelation chapter 17. Unquote. That's the point. Once the reformers got into their work on distributing Bibles in the common man's language and read it for themselves, they all saw that God revealed his opponent on earth, Satan, as clear as he revealed Jesus Christ would come in the Law and the Prophets. Everybody who understood the Bible knew the exact time of Jesus' coming. but people were misled by the Jews who brought the Babylonian Talmud with them and didn't teach the scripture, but taught Babylonian Talmudic teachings, and even laid a curse on everyone who wanted to read and study and determine the time prophesied by Daniel in chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. That's why understanding Daniel 9 in that part is so vital. Jesus Christ was announced to come all throughout the Law and the Prophets, or as most people call it, the Old Testament. And God did not deal deceitfully with his people. He told them when he was coming, what he would do, what he would say, and why he was here. And in the same way, God made it also clear to all of us Bible-believing Christians who the adversary of the body of Christ is. Satan, the dragon, the serpent, the deceiver, who the man of sin is, the son of perdition, the little horn, the Antichrist, the papacy. He made it very, very clear. And it has only become unclear because of the distortion of the Counter-Reformation, of the Jesuits who invented first preterism through Alcazar and then futurism through Francisco Ribera in the 1590s. And the teaching of this futurism from the middle of the 18th century on in the United States of America led to a Vatican Council II. And we are going to read about Vatican Council II also in chapter 2 that's coming up right now, called Roman Catholic Doctrine and the Mass. What Archbishop Temple had called supplemental truth, as you probably remember me from reading in the beginning of the first chapter, had been described by the Protestant reformers as errors. Errors which, when confronted, led to persecution, the Inquisition, martyrdom, and to secession of schism. These were among the leading doctrines of the Church of Rome, condemned in plain and unmistakable language 9 times over by the 39 Articles of the Church of England, wrote Bishop J.C. Ryle in 1885. A further problem for contemporary Protestants is that the errors have been compounded since the 16th century. The principles embodied by the Roman Catholic Church in the Council of Trent in 1545, confirming the dogma of error, have been reaffirmed by successive popes, including John Paul II today. But added to them now are the 3 new doctrines or dogmas of papal infallibility from 1870, the First Vatican Council, the Immaculate Conception of Mary in 1854, and the Assumption into Heaven of Mary, Mother of God, in 1950. Contrary to the understanding of very many people, Vatican II reversed no doctrine of the Church, nor did it make any recommendation to do so. So this is just a confirmation of what I said. Rome never changes. They did not reverse the doctrine of the Church, nor did they make any recommendation to do so. So what did they actually do? Well, we go into that in a moment. Salvation is the next part in the chapter called. Fundamental to the whole doctrinal divide is the issue of salvation itself. Justification by faith alone, according to Rome, is not sufficient. More grace is needed. This, we are told, is obtained through the sacraments, by further works and infused righteousness, leading into the doctrines of penance, purgatory, and plenary indulgences. Baptism, they say, is essential. The Church insists that Roman Catholics must be baptized in order to be saved. The Catechism defines baptism as the sacrament that gives our souls the new life of sanctifying grace by which we become children of God and heirs of heaven. It is necessary for the salvation of all men because Christ has said, quote, Unless a man be born again of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Unquote. The Second Vatican Council confirmed the long-standing dogma of Pope Boniface VIII of 1301, extra ecclesiam nulla salvas, which means no salvation outside of the Church of Rome. Quote, "It is through the Catholic Church alone that the whole fullness of the means of salvation can be obtained. All are obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved." Unquote. This is Pope Boniface VIII in 1301. And what did Pope Boniface VIII publish in 1302, just 1 year later? The Bull Unam Sanctam, where he states, "It is absolutely necessary for the salvation of every human creature to be subject to the Roman Pontiff." Where is that different from when he says a year before, "All are obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved"? Well, it's just taking it a little bit further. First, they have to be all part of the Roman Catholic Church in order to be saved. But then, even a year later, in the bull, he states that they all have to be subject to the Roman Pontiff, who is leading the Roman Catholic Church. So that means that when you enter the Roman Catholic Church, you absolutely give up all your authority to the Pope. All authority comes from him. That's what Boniface VIII stated in the Bull Unam Sanctam, 1 year after 1301, where he stated that all are obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved. So first the dogma, you must belong to the Roman Catholic Church, otherwise you are lost. And then he states that it is absolutely necessary for salvation of every human creature to be subject to the Roman Pontiff. So first they come into the church, and when they're into the church, well, then they all subject themselves to the Pope. That's what it's all about. That's it before 1301, that it is after 1301, still today, and it will be in the future. If you're a Roman Catholic, if you do not have the true Word of God with you, and know that Jesus teaches otherwise. Luther denied all this strenuously. He described justification by faith without works as the article of a standing or falling church, and he and the other reformers believed that Rome had unchurched herself and forfeited any right to the loyalty of men by denying the scriptural way of salvation. Rome denies the scriptural way of salvation. It puts their own traditions and their own dogmas before the Word of God. But we know that only the Word of God is truth. So everything the Roman Catholic Church then teaches when it does not adhere to the Bible cannot be the truth. Why are people still going in there? I don't get it. Bill Jackson, who boldly directs a ministry called Christians Evangelizing Catholics, that would be an interesting group to join, eh? In Louisville, Kentucky, speaks today with the same conviction. Quote, "Full forgiveness of sins, which are gloriously removed as far as the east is from the west, when we are redeemed through the completed work at Calvary, is replaced by priestly absolution, repeated confession, penances, and good works. Also, a confining and binding sense of guilt stands wholly in conflict with the truth in God's word concerning the cleansing and liberating of the blood of Christ." Unquote. The great doctrine of grace at the heart of the gospel is overthrown. We read for that in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Quote, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Unquote. Luther, a formidable theologian equipped with a mighty intellect and prodigious learning, after a lengthy and painful search for God and for assurance of salvation, discovered that he needed to lay all these things down in order to meet his Lord. Like so many millions of other Christians before and since, he came to see the truth regarding the simplicity of the new birth, as Paul told the Romans in Romans chapter 1 verse 17 and chapter 10 verse 9, quote, "The just shall live by faith, and if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved," unquote. We come to the Mass. At the heart of Roman Catholicism, at the heart of Roman Catholicism is the Mass, or Eucharist, described by the Second Vatican Council as, quote, "the fount and apex of the whole Christian life," unquote. Killian MacDonald, a distinguished Catholic theologian and president of the Institute for Ecumenical and Cultural Research in Minnesota, has spoken of how many will attest that one of the best expressions of the renewal is its Eucharist celebrations. In France, for instance, a number of important communities center their very lives around the Eucharist, unquote. Mary McCarthy, another renewal leader, testified that, quote, "attendance at daily Mass has grown to be my way of life. Through the Mass, Through the Mass, I receive the strength I need to witness to Christ and his teachings," unquote. Yeah, through the Mass, I am deceived, I should have read, but that's not what he said. He said that through the Mass, he is received. He receives the strength and need to witness to Christ and his teachings. I wonder why people like these never check the spirit that enters them. And by that, they just do not understand. They just do not get that that is another spirit. Not the Holy Spirit, but a demonical spirit. Rome claims that the Mass is a sacrifice. It is held to be one and the same sacrifice with that of the cross, inasmuch as Christ, who offered himself a bleeding victim on the cross to his heavenly Father, continues to offer himself in an unbloody manner on the altar through the ministry of his priests. Unquote. This is from A Catechism of Christian Doctrine, the Catholic Truth Society, London, 1985. Christ and the perpetual sacrifice as represented by his still hanging on the crucifix. You have to understand this. Christ is the perpetual sacrifice as represented by his still hanging on the crucifix. So whenever you enter a Roman Catholic church, there is not only a cross, but there is a cross with a hanging Jesus on it. Because his sacrifice is perpetual in the Roman Catholic Church. Jesus said, "It is finished." And we come to that in a second when we read on here. But what did he mean by "it is finished"? What do you think that he meant? Do you think that he meant only, "Oh, my earthly life is finished"? Or do you think, "My work is done"? Well, reading on, we come to learn about this. Christ is the perpetual sacrifice as represented by his still hanging on the crucifix. His words, "it is finished," do not mean that his sacrifice was finished, according to the Church of Rome, but that he had finished his earthly life and was now ready to offer himself as the perpetual victim or host. The offering is for the sins of the living and the dead, and the wafer and the wine are actually changed into the body and blood, the real presence, by the priest. The Catholic Encyclopedia defines this change, known as transubstantiation, as follows, quote, In the sacrament of the Eucharist, the substance of bread and wine do not remain, but the entire substance of bread is changed into the body of Christ, and the entire substance of wine is changed into his blood. The species or outward semblance of bread and wine only remaining. The dogma of the totality of the real presence means that in each individual species the whole Christ, flesh and blood, body and soul, divinity and humanity, is really present. Unquote. From the Catholic Encyclopedia, Volume 4, page 299, and Volume 14, page 586. Check it out for yourselves. You can still find that online and read that, and then compare that to what the Bible says. And then you know it is not Jogler 66 who says that. It's not Hour of the Truth that states that. It's the Word of God that is 180 degrees contradictory to what the Roman Catholic Church teaches. When the priest consecrates the bread and wine, he uses the words of Matthew 26:26, hoc est corpus meum. This is my body. In offering up the wafer, which now has become the whole Christ, he is seen to be sacrificing Christ. Now, what did the reformers have to say about the Mass? Luther, a former priest of the Church of Rome, described it as an unspeakable abomination, quite contrary to the principal article of justification by faith alone. Unquote. Calvin called it Satan's attempt to adulterate and envelop the sacred supper of Christ as with thick darkness. Unquote. Cranmer was no less forthright. Quote, for these be but false doctrines, without shame devised and feigned by wicked popish priests, idolaters, monks, and friars, which for lucre have altered and corrupted the most holy supper of the Lord and turned it into manifest idolatry. Wherefore all godly men ought with all their heart to refuse and abhor all such blasphemy against the Son of God. Unquote from Cranmer. The Council of Trent, you remember, 1545 to 1563, the first Jesuitical council after 5 years just after the foundation in 1540 by Pope Paul III, the Council of Trent gave the reformers the Roman Catholic reply, uncompromising its stance today, having been endorsed by the Second Vatican Council, which altered style, not substance. Quote, if anyone shall say that in the Mass there is not offered to God a true, proper, and propitiatory sacrifice for the living and the dead, or what is offered is nothing else than Christ given to be eaten, i.e. transubstantiation, let him be anathema, meaning let him be accursed, let him be damned. If anyone shall say that in these words, this do in remembrance of me, let him be anathema. Unquote. So the Council of Trent actually says, when you say the same words that Jesus used, this do in remembrance of me, you are cursed. Can it be any clearer that the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church is 180 degrees contrary to what the Bible teaches? I don't think so. There is a need to emphasize that there has been no change in essence in the Mass since the Council of Trent. A Catholic Truth Society 1985 booklet, How the Mass Came to Be, confirms this. Quote, thanks to the Second Vatican Council and Pope Paul VI, we have a new liturgy today. But with all the changes, what we have is truly the Mass of Christ. What has changed is the manner of its celebration, the liturgy. For there can never be a new Mass. Vatican II held that the language of the Mass has changed, not the substance. Unquote. again, I repeat myself, Rome never changes, and they admit it here for themselves. The language changed, not the substance. Rome never changes anything. That has been affirmed in the Council of Trent, it has been reaffirmed in the Second Vatican Council, 1962 through 1965, and that is still Catholic dogma today, 2016. We come to the Blessed Sacrament. A 1988 booklet, also published by the Catholic Truth Society, explains the special significance for Catholics of the Blessed Sacrament. Communion for the sick is still the primary purpose for the reservation of the sacrament in our churches, but it is only natural that once reserved for that purpose, the sacramental presence of the Lord should be revered and adored. Our worship of Christ by focusing on the exposed sacrament should always lead us to a deeper love for the actual celebration of the Eucharist and to a more fruitful reception in communion of the body and blood of the Lord. At its heart, the Eucharist is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Unquote. Now, this last sentence I call absolute blasphemy, taking the words right out of the Bible, right out of context where they are written there, where it says God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and they say the Eucharist is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it is these little, I call them little, they are big, but they are big lies, but I call them little lies. This little truth, these statements from the Bible, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It is these little truths mixed with all the error that keep the people in the Roman Catholic Church. Oh, see, they cite the Bible. They say actually what is in the Bible. How can they be wrong? Well, they take it out of context. The Bible never says that the Eucharist is the same yesterday, today, and forever, but God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Catholic concept of the sacrament and the Eucharist is illustrated in the description given by Mother Teresa of Calcutta in one of her meditations. And don't let me even get started on Mother Teresa, that satanic, devilish woman. And if you do not agree with me, well, then do your own research and you will find out what a satanic woman Mother Teresa actually was. She says, quote, "It is beautiful to see the humility of Christ. In his permanent state of humility in the tabernacle, where he has reduced himself to such a small particle of bread that the priest can hold him with two fingers." Unquote. Cardinal John Henry Newman, 19th century theologian, described by Pope Paul VI and John Paul II as the man who inspired the Second Vatican Council, placed his supreme trust in the Blessed Sacrament. Quote, "When you think everything is gone from you," he said in 1875 after the death of his friend Father Ambrose St. John, "if you have with you our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament, you still have everything." Unquote. Shortly before the Lord Jesus shared the Last Supper with his disciples, he prophesied about deception and false Christs. In what has become known as the Olivet Discourse, given on the Mount of Olives, he gave an unmistakable warning. Quote, "If any man shall say unto you, Lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not." Unquote. So the Roman Catholic Church, whenever they hold a Mass with the Eucharist, so-called, quote-unquote, produce Christ out of heaven, with the priest saying the words, "Hoc est corpus meum," actually demanding, ordering God, Jesus, from the throne in heaven into that little wafer cookie and gives it to you and says, "This is the body and soul, the divinity and the humanity, the blood and flesh of Jesus Christ." What is that else as Jesus warned us about, if any man shall say unto you, lo, he is Christ, or there, believe it not. Look, I hold up the wafer, he is Christ. Believe it not. Jesus warned us himself. So get it. Rome is nothing but deception. I think I have to go a little bit quicker, otherwise I can't finish the chapter here. Okay, Jörg, a little less commenting, a little more reading. Jesus took bread in the upper room to symbolize his broken body. He did not take a round wafer. Alexander Hislop, author of The Two Babylons, which was first published fully in 1858 and yet has not aged in content, argues that, quote, the round wafer, whose roundness is so important an element of the Romish mystery, is only another symbol of Baal, or the sun. Hislop notes that it is striking to find that the image of the sun was erected on high above the altars in the worship of Baal, as practiced by the idolatrous Israelites in the days of their apostasy, as we can read in 2 Chronicles chapter 34, verse 4. Now, in another book that you probably know when you followed my YouTube channel a little bit, I did a reading on the book Babylon, Mystery Religion by Ralph Woodrow. And here we come to another quote of that book here, so you can always check for confirmation me completely reading that book on my channel. In his book Babylon Mystery Religion, Californian author Ralph Woodrow describes the huge altar in St. Peter's Cathedral in Rome and the four 95 feet columns that support it. At the top of each column is a sun-like image, those that were used in pagan worship. High on the wall also is a very large and elaborate golden sunburst image, just as there was in the great temple of Babylon. The sunburst images are also like the monstrance sun image, in which the host is placed as a sun, and before which Catholics kneel and bow. Similar sun images have been discovered above the altar in temples excavated to reveal the Egypt of the pharaohs. Inscriptions found on the temple walls have demonstrated that the thin round cakes of the ancient mysteries were to be found on every altar. Hislop identified the cakes of those offered to the Queen of Heaven, the unbloody sacrifice required by the Goddess Mother and offered to her by the Israelites, as read in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 18. The round disc, wrote Hislop here, so frequent in the sacred emblems of Egypt, symbolized the sun. Now, when Osiris, the sun divinity, became incarnate and was born, it was not merely that he would give his life as a sacrifice for men, but that he might be the life and nourishment of the souls of men. Now, this sun was symbolized as corn, was the sun, S-U-N, divinity incarnate, according to the sacred oracle of the great goddess of Egypt. Quote, no mortal has lifted my veil. The fruit which I have brought forth is the sun, S-U-N, unquote. What more natural than if this incarnate divinity is symbolized as the bread of God, than that he should be represented as a round wafer to identify him with the sun. Unquote from the Two Babylons. And the point I want to make here, just a little second, that you understand that very well. The priests of Baal were called Cana Baal. Cana, the Chaldaic word for priest, Cana. Baal means priest of Baal. From that word we derive our word cannibal today. So what are these priests else but cannibals? Because they produce the literal body, soul, divinity, humanity, flesh and blood of Jesus Christ and eat it. They're cannibals and making the people who eat the Eucharist, cannibals, also. They say Here, it is an unbloody sacrifice, but it represents blood and body and flesh of Jesus Christ. And you will see as I read on that I'm really not going out of any limb here when I state that. Now, the burning issue. Protestants, or those who profess the inerrancy and total authority of the Scriptures, see the Mass as contrary to Scripture, in particular in the book of Hebrews. I have to repeat that sentence because I hope you understood it. Protestants, and then between brackets, are those who profess the inerrancy and total authority of the Scriptures, brackets closed, see the Mass as contrary to Scripture, in particular in the book of Hebrews. I do not call myself a Protestant anymore, but I am, like between brackets stated here, one who professes the inerrancy and total authority of the Scriptures. Scripture is infallible, because Scripture, the Bible, is the Word of God, and man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God, and the Bible is His Word. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 12, quote, "But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God." And in the same book, chapter 9, verse 27, we read, quote, "And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time, without sin, unto salvation." Unquote. These two verses summarize the total, once and for all, saving works of the atonement. The 28th of the 39 Articles of the Church of England from 1571 declares, quote, "Transubstantiation is repugnant to the plain words of Scripture, overthroweth the nature of a sacrament, and hath given occasion to many superstitions. The sacrament of the Lord's Supper was not by Christ's ordinance reserved, carried about, worshipped, nor was it lifted up." Unquote. Contrast this with Pope John the 23rd accounts of a Mass he attended before Vatican II. Quote, "Our voice trembling with emotion, the central guiding and shining point of that meeting. Our consecrated and blessed hands raised aloft the Eucharistic sacrifice, Jesus our Savior and Redeemer." Unquote. Martin Luther considered that the Babylonian captivity of the Church consisted in the denial to the laity of communion in both kinds, bread and wine, and in the doctrines of transubstantiation and the sacrifice of the Mass. The English Reformers flatly denied the doctrine of the real presence of Christ in the Mass and insisted on the key words, "in remembrance of me," of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, and for that reason many of them were burned at the stake. The English Reformation centered around this very issue. One after another, Rogers, Bradford, Bishops Hooper, Latimer and Ridley, Archbishop Cranmer, all went to their deaths denying a doctrine which they felt damaged and obscured the whole system of Christ's truth. They knew the importance to posterity of their stand. When the Banner of Truth Trust republished Five English Reformers, abridged in 1960 from Bishop J.C. Riley's 1890 classic Light from All Times, the publishers of the Banner were themselves moved to write an introduction which brought a sobering message, part of which is reproduced here. It includes a solemn warning about the re-establishing of the Mass from the great evangelical bishop and a prediction already fulfilled. So listen close. A lengthy quote follows. "While we sleep, an onslaught is being mounted against us, an onslaught which the Protestant churches of our land were nevertheless ready to sustain. Anglican and nonconformist leaders alike have thrown away the only weapon that could defend us, the sword of the Spirit, the infallible Word of God. The Word of God alone, the grace of God alone, the power of the Spirit alone, these were the watch cries which prevailed for 400 years ago. They are not the watch cries of our Protestant pulpits today, even not in 2016, even less. J.C. Ryle, the first bishop of Liverpool, as a student in Oxford in the 1830s, witnessed the commencement of the Romeward movement in the Church of England, and he lived long enough to see the stream become a flood which he, which, as he prophesied in his old age, might in the next century carry all before it. Flood, you can even call it a tsunami. Ryle's convictions on this subject were thought out over a long period. He was no hasty alarmist, but he watched Rome's power grow. He had reread our church history. He knew human nature, and he spoke accordingly. Quote, "A sapping and mining process has been long going on under our feet, of which we are beginning at last to see a little. We shall see a good deal more by and by. At the rate we are going, it would never surprise me if within 50 years the crown of England were no longer on a Protestant head, and High Mass were once more celebrated in Westminster Abbey and St. Paul's." It is solemn to note that on 2 February 1960 a service of Requiem Mass was held for the late Earl of Halifax at Westminster Abbey. Unquote. From the Five English Reformers, Banner of Truth, February 1960. Ryle argued that the Romish doctrine of the real presence, if pursued to its legitimate consequences, obscures every leading doctrine of the gospel and damages and interferes with the whole system of Christ's truth. It produces an idolatry to be abhorred of faithful Christians. Did the Apostle Paul deal with the problem for us today as well as for the Corinthians of his day in his second letter? Quote, "And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you." Unquote. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 16 and 17. The writer to the Hebrews reminded them that Jesus Christ has an unchangeable priesthood. He needs not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice first of his own sins and then for the people's, for he did once when he offered up himself, as we can read in Hebrews chapter 7, verses 24 and 27. It was scriptures like these and Revelation 18, verse 4. "Come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues," that brought about and motivated the Protestant Reformation. What then of the expression of the renewal in Eucharistic celebrations? The new enthusiasm for the Mass among charismatic Catholics? Does it represent hope for unity in the Church, or is it rather the flickering of Hugh Latimer's candle, lit by the Reformers and now in danger of extinction? Well, next part is the re-establishing of the Mass. We'll see. In October 1988, the Lord Chancellor, Lord Mackay, was suspended as an elder of his church, the Free Presbyterian Church of Scotland, for attending two separate Requiem Masses for his friends. The Kirk's position, represented editorially as one of almost unbelievable bigotry, is in fact the constitutional position of the Queen and royal family. The BBC in their program coverage referred frequently to the principle that had motivated the Kirk, but that principle did not find expression or obtain definition in most of the media. There has been considerable concern about Prince Charles's attendance at a Mass in September 1986 at Kirkby-Stephen in Cumbria with his friends Hugh and Emily van Cutsem. earlier, as heir to the throne, he was prevented by command of the Queen from participating in the Pope's private mass at the Vatican. But the Prince of Wales also attended the mass during his visit to Normandy for the commemoration of the landings in 1944. Until this century, the 20th century that still is, so last century, the mass has been outlawed for the sovereign and his heirs in the coronation oath, which was designed to place both king and country under the authority of the Holy Bible. It was in 1910 and a decade before home rule of the heir before home rule of heir that an Esquith government, clinging to office and under pressure from the Irish nationalists as well as the sacerdotalists in the Anglican Church, removed the offending 1689 wording, which prohibited the monarch and the heirs to the throne from any exposure to the mass. At his coronation, George V's oath would have included, quote, "I, George, do solemnly and sincerely, in the presence of God, profess, testify, and declare that I do believe that in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper there is not any transubstantiation of the elements of bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ at or after the consecration thereof by any person whatsoever, and that the invocation or adoration of the Virgin Mary and any other saint and the sacrifice of the Mass, as they are now used in the Church of Rome, are superstitious and idolatrous." Unquote. This safeguard, as it surely was intended to be, is in keeping with Archbishop Cranmer's solemn warning to the Church about the Mass. Now, what did Cranmer warn us about the Mass? Quote, "What availeth it to take away breads, pardons, pilgrimages, and such other like popery, so long as the two chief roots remain unpulled up? So long as they remain, there will spring up the former impediments of the Lord's harvest, and corruption of the flock. The rest is but branches and leaves, the cutting away whereof is like topping and lopping of a tree, or cutting down the weeds, leaving the body standing and the roots in the ground. But the very body of the tree, or rather the roots of the weeds, is the popish doctrine of transubstantiation, of the real presence of Christ's flesh and blood in the sacrament of the altar, as they call it, and of the sacrifice and oblation of Christ made by the priest for the salvation of the quick and the dead. Which roots, if they be suffered to grow in the Lord's vineyard, will overspread all the ground again with the old errors and superstitions." Unquote. And we come to finish up the last part of chapter 2, called Attendance, then and now, speaking of the attendance of the Mass. "The principle of the Free Presbyterians that the BBC spoke of, which is outlined in their 1989 booklet Free Presbyterians and the Requiem Mass, is a long-standing one. At the time of the Reformation, Protestant leaders would not agree to Christians attending the Mass without making a protest against it. Calvin had very firm views about attendance of the Mass. Reformed Christians in his day were in danger if they failed to attend, and many of them wanted to conceal the fact that they were Protestants. However, Calvin strongly opposed the view that Protestants could attend Mass while at the same time secretly disapproving of it in their hearts." I'm sorry, I still have to make here a little comment. It's something that I said over and over again while reading Babylon Mystery Religion and probably also Hour of the Truth shows. I say it over and over again. When you believe in God of the Bible and you believe in Jesus Christ and that He saved you and that He died for you on the cross, everything else, and then you go into a Roman Catholic Church and you attend the Mass and you participate in the Eucharist, you are giving honor, you are giving worship to the God of the Roman Catholic Church, which is Satan, the serpent, the dragon, in the position of the Pope, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the little horn. You don't know it, maybe, but that doesn't mean that you don't do it. I mean, they don't tell you these things. They say, well, it is Jesus Christ, it is bloody soul, divinity, humanity, flesh and blood of Jesus. But if you say that it is not, when you say, well, that is only spoken of symbolically, then you are, as we just read a few pages ago, then you are anathema, right? It says so. If anyone shall say that in the Mass there is not offered to a true, proper and propitiatory sacrifice for the living and the dead, or what is offered is nothing else than Christ given to be eaten, i.e. transubstantiation, let him be anathema. If anyone shall say that in these words, this do in remembrance of me, let him be anathema. So even when you think, well, I can do this sacrifice, I can participate in that, I don't believe in it anyway. No, you are giving honor to the God of the Roman Catholic Church, which is not the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. And when you don't even know that because you are a betrayed Catholic and haven't read books like this and haven't read your Bible, then you think that you are doing God a service, but you are not, because you are saving Baal at that same moment. Such action would not be worship but dishonor our God, as I just explained. The stakes were much higher in those times, and Calvin knew that his stand was endangering lives. Although it made him deeply unpopular, he still maintained on the strongest grounds that Christian men ought not even to be present at the Mass. Calvin saw Paul's words to the Corinthians, "Flee from idolatry," as the imperative form, from the Lord, as we can read in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14. So, do not even attend a Mass, is what he said. Christian men ought not even to be present at the Mass. I don't say that I agree with everything Calvin said. I'm not a Calvinist. That's not the point. But I absolutely agree with what he says here, because that's scriptural. And you can read for that 1 Corinthians 10:14. This is in marked contrast to the approach of the charismatic renewal and the new evangelicalism so prevalent in the church today. In 1978, Dr. Donald Coggan became the first Archbishop of Canterbury since the reign of Mary I to attend papal mass. Robert Runcie also attended a papal mass in Rome in October 1989, although it was made clear to him by Vatican officials that he was not permitted to take communion. During the last two decades, there has been a new emphasis on sacramental worship, with the Mass regularly celebrated at Sunday services and references to it on television and in radio plays and documentaries as representative of Christian worship have become a noticeable feature in our lives. Christmas 1990 offered viewers four televised services, of which three were Masses. Requiem Masses, including prayers for the dead, have frequently occupied center stage at times of national tragedy and disaster. Thus, the reinstatement of the Mass in the public mind and in the life of our nation is becoming a reality in our day. Even though many reformers warned, and one who was not mentioned here and who warned of the coming danger of Roman Catholicism in the mid 19th century was James Aitken Wylie. He wrote many books, and one of the books that Tom Fress read at the end of last year and starting of this year on First Amendment Radio and Inquisition Update, Rome and Civil Liberty. Read that book. Very, very important. Surely when you are following my readings like Rulers of Evil, Babylon, Mystery Religion, and now All Roads Lead to Rome, also follow that book that Tom Fress read there. Thus, the reinstatement of the Mass in the public mind and in the life of our nation is becoming a reality nowadays. Why? Because they brainwash us through the television and radio where they just put it. And then you watch it and then you see, oh, it's okay. And you don't care anymore. So I've come to the end of chapter 2, and next time we will read chapter 3, The Virgin Mary, in the wonderful book from Michael de Semlyen, All Roads Lead to Rome, The Ecumenical Movement. I hope you enjoyed me reading this as much as I enjoyed reading it to you. That you enjoyed watching the movie, watching the video, and listening to my voice. I hope to see you again. I'm looking forward to your comments in the comment section. And until next time, take care. God bless you. And Jokler 66 from Hour of the Truth signing off. And bye bye.
We as Bible-believing Christians, we know that the hand that is behind ISIS, the hand that is behind Al-Qaeda, is the same hand that is behind the United States of America government, that is behind the European Union government, and that is behind all the armies in the world, and that is behind all these mercenary companies out in the world, like XE, or formerly called Blackwater, run by Knights of Malta, etc., etc. So this is something that you really have to understand. This is all just a theater. And the point is, where is this theater going to lead to? When you are a Bible-believing Christian, you know that in the end times, Jesus warned us in Matthew 24, there will be wars, wars, and rumors of wars. And we know that the Antichrist, by peace, will destroy many, and so on, and so on, and so on. I could start citing the whole Bible up and down right now with citations like this to tell you what it's all about. But I don't have to sing to the choir or preach to the choir. You, as Bible-believing Christians, already know that. So the only thing that I ask of you is don't be caught in their game. Because when you are and you play their game, you have to play by their rules. And their rules are not Christ's rules. So the only thing that I can advise you of is, okay, take that information in what happens about there. Pray for the people that these victims are being taken good care of, and that they are just deceived people, that they maybe have a chance. By going through this situation, maybe they have a way to find to Christ in this way. Maybe they have a way to find to the real truth. I mean, these people are Muslims and coming from Muslim countries and coming to so-called, quote-unquote, Christian countries. Of course, the Roman Catholic Church is not Christian. Of course, the Protestant churches today don't preach any protest anymore. All right, I know that. Still, here and there, it is possible that a grain falls on the ground that can fall on fruitful ground, even with these refugees and the whole situation that is coming up. And that is the hope that we should have as Bible-believing Christians, and that is the prayer that we should use every day when we address our Lord, to pray for our enemies as we pray for our friends. Because Jesus said, love your enemies. And love your neighbor.